I'm going to tell you the best PSP games on the PS Vita you don't usually hear people talk about. That is, unless it's Metal Jesus and he's talking about hidden gems. Now, these are the games that usually get overshadowed by the God of Wars and the GTAs. I'm going to try my best to give some of the lesser known games a chance. And as a reminder, these games are only available for the North American region. Before I start the countdown, I want to give a very big shout out to Windy Corner TV and Revolution 360. One covers every type of game you can possibly think of, and the other has some of the best looking thumbnails I've ever seen on YouTube. Number 10. Darkstalkers Chronicle Chaos Tower. I once read that Darkstalkers was basically a Street Fighter clone with monsters being substituted in. It makes sense since it was developed by Capcom, but upon closer inspection, you can tell there's a little more going on. For one thing, you can tell there's a lot more care and attention put into the visual artwork. That's not to say Street Fighter didn't look good, it's just that Darkstalkers had a few more frames of animation that made it more state-of-the-art, at least in comparison to Street Fighter Alpha, and to some extent, Street Fighter 3 even. This is evident when you pull off a super move, as they're highly detailed and super creative, even surpassing those from the Street Fighter series. I arrived to the whole Darkstalkers scene kinda late, so I was a little intimidated with all the different set of options offered in Chaos Tower. More specifically, the various different set of rules you can play by. One option lets you play your traditional best of three rounds, while another features a continuous match where the opponent immediately gets back up after being knocked down. What I always found interesting about the franchise, or at least in this particular game, is the way super moves are executed. Normally, in Street Fighter, when a super move is activated, the entire screen freezes for a second, and then the animation starts. In Darkstalkers Chronicle, the super moves sort of just come out. I'm not sure if I like that, to be honest. It kind of takes away from the super move in a sense. Sometimes I'm left wondering, was that a super move or a special move? If you're familiar with the Street Fighter series, you'll notice a few similar mechanics have made their way over to Darkstalkers Chronicle. Special moves can be enhanced, combos can be started with 2-in-1s, tech hit for escaping throws, as well as guard cancels, which you will notice a resemblance to alpha counters. There is, however, one offensive technique here that's not found in the Street Fighter series. That's the ability to attack an opponent when they're on the ground. It's weird to pull off at first, and it's not something you normally find in Capcom 2D fighters, but it's cool nonetheless. With the ability to unlock hidden artwork, vibrant 2D graphics, and various gameplay options, it's gonna be hard to pass on Darkstalkers Chronicle, especially if you're a fan of Capcom 2D fighters. Number 9. Metal Slug Double X. I always wondered where this game fell in the Metal Slug timeline. It's actually an enhanced version of Metal Slug 7, if you're familiar with that game. This new edition includes new features and differences that only hardcore fans of the franchise will be able to pick out, such as the reappearance of certain enemy types, reused sound effects from previous games, as well as changes to ammo distribution. Of course, I'm the last person you should ask regarding the Metal Slug games. I'm no expert on the subject, nor will I pretend to be, but I can tell you this, it is good, mindless fun if you've got time to kill on a lunch break. A 2D run-and-gun game with amazing hand-drawn visuals that is not just fun to play, but fun to watch. I'm constantly amazed at how much animation was put into this game. It's like a few frames away from being an actual cartoon, which is quite rare for a game developed by SNK. I played some of the KOF games and never really thought it looked very good, especially when compared to the Street Fighter games. But I can say with confidence that Metal Slug is one of the few franchises that can go toe-to-toe with some of the best from Capcom. At least in terms of visual aesthetics, the way enemies crumble to the ground, the way structures and combat vehicles shatter into a million pieces are a work of art. The animation from the flamethrower has to be my favorite. The boss fights are also something to look forward to, each one different from the last and each one providing a visual extravaganza. The game might not be as deep, but boy is it pretty. Number 8. Medal of Honor Heroes. If anyone remembers playing this on the PSP, you'll know the controls were less than ideal. The left thumbstick was used for moving the character around, and the right face buttons were used for aiming. It wasn't the greatest setup in my opinion, and I think a lot of gamers out there would have to agree. But things are different now on the PS Vita. You can now swap the PSP's face button controls for the Vita's right analog stick. You'll notice a world of difference after you do, putting the game more in line with modern first-person shooters today. I honestly don't think I'd ever be able to play it any other way. Also, don't forget to invert the controls after you swap out the face buttons. If you're familiar with Medal of Honor games on the PS1, then you'll be right at home here. Mission objectives range from blowing stuff up, killing a certain amount of enemies, capturing enemy intel, and finding escape routes. There's also an online multiplayer feature allowing up to 32 players in a match. I doubt it still even works, but you're welcome to try. Let me know if you get matched with anyone. Aside from a few graphical anomalies, the visuals are pretty solid. It might lack some of the finer details from the PS1 titles, but as a result, the game as a whole runs a little bit smoother. At least to me it does. Enemy death animations are still awesome to look at, so you don't have to worry about those. The weapon effects still sound authentic, but the musical score isn't as strong as it once was on the PS1. At times I feel like the games might be a little too quiet. Even if there's no music playing, there's hardly ambient noise either. It just sounds kinda dead. But other than that, I think it's a great game with a solid single player campaign. If you're itching for some World War II portable first person shooting, then this is the one to get. Number 7. Dissidia Final Fantasy. Who needs the new Final Fantasy VII Remake when you've got Dissidia on the PSP? I wasn't sure what kind of game this was before I played it, and to be honest, I'm still not sure what kind of game it is. It's labeled as a fighting game with action RPG elements featuring characters from different Final Fantasy games. I wasn't able to play against anyone else, but I did manage to try out the story mode, which to my surprise was actually very cool, or at least from what I could understand. The battle system isn't too complicated. Imagine a more sophisticated version of Kingdom Hearts and you'll get an idea. Still, if you don't understand it, random button mashing can also yield some amazing results. New weapons and armor as well as other abilities can be equipped before a match, helping to add that RPG flair. The music is also very well done, reminiscent of past Final Fantasy games. The nostalgia hits hard with this one, so be prepared. And the controls are not difficult at all, really. Simple button combinations may be required, but overall, there's not a lot of finger gymnastics involved. Graphically, the game is a knockout. Colorful animated characters and awesome looking visual effects during battle. Some of the fights look like they were taken straight from Dragon Ball Z. Other graphical touches like character art from previous games make a return. I also love that little chocobo that appears on the bottom of the screen. Not a big deal, but simple little things like that add so much to the overall presentation. It's almost as if Square Enix made this specifically for old school Final Fantasy fans. Regardless, I think whether you're new or old, everyone in between will enjoy this game. Number 6. Burnout Dominator. Before you try searching for this game on your PS Vita, just know that it's one of those games that only appears while you're on your PS3. I think it also shows up if you're on the PlayStation mobile app. The trick to getting it on your Vita is to first download it on the PS3 and then transferring it over. I'm pretty sure you can do a quick Google search on how to do that. Burnout Dominator is the second portable Burnout game to be released on the PlayStation Portable. It is also the first game in the series to not have been developed by Criterion Games. The main focus this time is the return of Burnouts. It's where you basically drain your boost meter without stopping after it turns blue. Honestly, I couldn't even tell you if the game is any different from the rest of them. I just go as fast as I can while trying to take out as many other cars as I can. And that's the beauty of this game. You don't need to know what's really going on. The single player mode comes in the form of World Tour, consisting of various different races. Some require you to complete a race as fast as possible, while another will test your ability to drift around corners. Everything else is pretty standard if you're familiar with Burnout games. My favorite type of race would have to be Road Rage. This is probably what most people think of when they see a Burnout game. Race against the clock and take out as many opponents as you can. There is a neat little feature, which I don't remember the previous Burnout games having. Now, I know there was a thing called Aftertouch, where you could slow down the game if you were taken out, but was there a thing called Crash Breaker? It essentially makes your car explode, taking out nearby opponents. I thought this was just so cool. Graphics are good, although I think the courses could have used a little more color. There's like a really gritty look to everything. And the car deformations could be better also, I think. Vehicles fly through the air almost like a crushed can of tuna, with the occasional car door hanging off the side. It doesn't look bad, but it's definitely a setback from what I remember it being on the consoles. Of course, there is a trade-off. The game runs super smooth. I'm not sure if it's 30 frames or 60 frames, but it sure does look fast. The audio sounds like any other Burnout game before it. Loud crashes and a fully licensed soundtrack. Some of it is either hit or miss depending on your taste, but I think there's a nice variety in there that will please most people. I just have one question. Why are there four different versions of Avril Lavigne's Girlfriend? Was that song really that popular back then? And of course, the best track on the list, Rockstar Remix. Now that song is lit. Number 5. Soul Calibur Broken Destiny. Good lord, does this game look amazing on the PlayStation Vita. I will go so far as to say this PSP game looks better than some of the PS Vita fighters out there right now. Originally released on the PSP, Broken Destiny features content from Soul Calibur 4. Aside from the two Star Wars characters that were featured in that game, all 28 fighters make a return, in addition to the PSP exclusive, Kratos. I just realized something. Kratos appears in both Mortal Kombat and Soul Calibur Broken Destiny. Maybe we can get a Mortal Kombat vs. Soul Calibur game one day? The game plays as you would expect if you're familiar with Soul Calibur. All fighting mechanics have been flawlessly brought over to the handheld, and it all runs without a hitch. Frame rate is not a problem with this game. Control-wise, Broken Destiny handles exactly as it does in the consoles. This is thanks in part to the four-button layout that Soul Calibur fans have been accustomed to all these years. It's also gorgeous, by the way. There's a lot of detail in the fighters, and backgrounds look like they were taken straight from the console versions. But for everything Broken Destiny does right, it falls short of perfection because of one missing feature, at least in my opinion. I always had to throw that disclaimer out or else everyone goes apeshit on me. The absence of an arcade mode seriously hurts this game. The closest thing is probably the Trials of Attack, but even then it still doesn't feel quite the same. Quick Match seems almost like a simulated online experience without actually having to be online. I thought that was kinda neat. You've got the Gauntlet, which is basically your tutorial mode. It's helpful for learning the deeper fighting mechanics, but some of the challenges can be a little confusing. There's also the character customization feature, which you can't spend a ton of hours in. Unfortunately, you won't be able to share your creation with other people since there's no online multiplayer, which I doubt would work now even if there was one. So the only other option is Versus mode, which let players connect through an ad hoc network. I wasn't able to try that out, just so you know. Everything else about this game is great. I just wish there was an arcade mode. Just goes to show how important this feature is for the overall presentation in a fighting game. Such a shame. Oh, and there's also a very helpful training mode as well. Number 4. Ape Escape on the Loose. Also known as Ape Escape P for my European fans out there. This is actually a port of Ape Escape on the PS1 for those who didn't know. I don't think this game went over very well with fans, but I rather enjoyed it. It's probably because it was my first time playing Ape Escape, so I wasn't really expecting anything. And maybe also the fact that I didn't have to play it on the PSP. Thanks to the Vita's control setup, you can now remap the D-pad to the second analog stick. For those familiar with the original, this control setup now plays a lot closer to the PS1 version. The first thing that caught my attention about this game was the presentation. It has a very anime-ish kind of vibe to it. In some ways, it sort of reminds me of Mega Man Powered Up. It has a kiddie and playful look, but not overly cute where you want to throw up or anything. Stages are structured in a similar fashion to something you see in Mario 64, or even Banjo-Kazooie. The goal of the game is basically to find and catch monkeys scattered throughout the level. It's simple in its design, but is pretty in-depth once you acquire some of the more advanced gadgets. Sometimes you'll have to use a radar to detect where a monkey is hiding. Other times you'll have to sneak around on your stomach to avoid being seen, similar to Solid Snake from the Metal Gear games. Most of the monkeys can easily be found, while others will take some head-scratching to figure out. Trust me, it's a lot tougher than it looks. There's a lot of monkey jokes thrown in there, which I have to admit are pretty funny considering the game's age. If you've never played this before and want to try something completely different, then give Ape Escape a try. Its colorful graphics, unique gameplay, and numerous pop culture references will definitely make you a fan. Number 3. Pursuit Force. You're placed in the role of a police agent sent out to seize gang vehicles while engaging in high-speed chases and gun battles. It's part driving, part action, and part third-person shooting. The game starts out simple enough, with you basically escorting a witness to a designated area, but then the mayhem starts. Chases can take part on land or water. Gunfights are not just limited to one vehicle, as you'll have the ability to hop from car to car, which you will have to do since the vehicle you're on can only sustain so much damage. It's all very over-the-top action that is quite badass when you start to figure things out. It's a crazy concept for a game, but it looks even crazier in action. The funny thing is that it all works. I think it's hilarious how you can shoot a car in back of you, yet still be able to steer through traffic. Car handling is extremely tight, and thank God for that because you'll need to be able to weave in and out of traffic. I couldn't help but think of Bad Boys 2 when I played this. The aiming isn't too bad either, as it's handled by an automatic lock-on feature. There are various weapons to pick up, but honestly, I didn't even pay attention. Things were moving so fast I didn't even have time to think. I was either shooting someone behind me, hopping onto another vehicle, or dodging incoming bullets. There's never a dull moment as you'll find yourself under constant enemy fire. The game is also quite the looker. Beautiful looking explosions and a speedy frame rate make this one of the prettier games on the PSP. The action can chug ever so slightly, but considering how much is going on, you're more than willing to forgive. My only complaint is that there is a slight difficulty spike early on in the game. I was told that the US release of this game was actually made easier. I can't imagine what the earlier version of this game was like. If you can make it past the first initial hump, then get ready for one hell of a ride. Number 2. The Third Birthday. Bruh. This is hands down one of the coolest games I've ever played. Fun fact, it was directed by a certain Hajime Tabata, For you Square Enix fans, that name should ring a bell. The Third Birthday is a third-person role-playing shooter that is also, funny enough, the third entry in the Parasite Eve series. Although it's the third game in the series, it has very loose connections with previous events. It's more of a spin-off, to be honest. But you know what? That doesn't really matter, because this game is still awesome. Showcasing some of the best visuals for a PSP title, the game now looks even better on the Vita display. You'll notice plenty of detail throughout your adventure. From the accumulated damage your character sustains to enemy explosions after being defeated, the game is a sight to behold. Environments are fully fleshed out with dark, moody colors, and bosses are gigantic with a ton of effects going off in every direction. You can tell the Third Birthday came out during the later half of the PSP's lifespan, as every trick in the book is being used to pull off this graphical feat. Although the game mainly functions as a third-person shooter, it also utilizes a mechanic called dive, where you're able to jump in and out of other characters, either to switch positions or cause additional damage. It's the first I've ever seen of this, and in my opinion, it works pretty well. It's sort of like Agent Smith jumping from one body to another. Has anyone here seen The Matrix? I'm not sure how it controlled on the original PSP, but on the Vita, it plays like a dream. Well, maybe not a dream, but it turned out a lot better than I had anticipated. And it's all thanks to the fact that you can reconfigure the Vita's right analog stick to work as the camera. There were some instances where the action got a little hectic, but for the most part, the game is easy to navigate. The music reminds me so much of Final Fantasy VII Advent Children. It has this dark, cold, creepy kind of feel to it. It fits the game perfectly, in my opinion. There are only two minor complaints I have with this game. The first is that it doesn't really explain to you what those DNA strand things are, or how to go about using them. A little tutorial would have helped. Another thing I thought was annoying were the boss encounters. As awesome as they may be, the game isn't always clear on how to defeat them. Your only hope is to listen in on your teammates for clues on what to do. There is some trial and error needed, maybe even a little luck. With a little perseverance, it can be done, but I think it would have made the game a lot more approachable had it been a little more clear on this part. If you're feeling left out because everyone else is playing Final Fantasy VII Remake, then consider picking up the Third Birthday. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised. Number 1. The Red Star. This, my friend, is the definition of a hidden gem. I'm looking at you, Metal Jesus. I originally was planning to have the Third Birthday take the number 1 spot until I played the Red Star. 10 minutes into it, I'm like, oh no, this definitely has to be number 1 on the list. The Red Star plays like a mix of different game genres all mashed into one. It starts out like your standard beat-em-up, but then transitions into a shooter during boss encounters. It goes back and forth between the two so seamlessly that you often never notice. Because of this, the game never gets dull or repetitive. Regular enemies require more than random button mashing to defeat, and bosses have various attack patterns that not only look cool, but always keep you on your toes. There's also some RPG elements thrown in there too. Depending on how well you complete a level, you're awarded points that can be used to upgrade your character's attributes. It's not the most complex system, but it works for this particular game. You're given a choice of two selectable characters, with a third being an unlockable after completing the game. One character prioritizes speed while the other strength. Unlike most beat-em-ups, these characters control quite differently, each one having their own strengths and weaknesses. Choosing which character to start out with actually makes a difference this time. The sound is also amazing. If you're familiar with past vertical shooters, then you'll get a sense of what you'll get here. Now, the graphics for the most part is solid. There's no shortage of awesome screen-filling explosions. There's one stage that had a really cool looking ice ground that showed the reflection of the sky. I thought that was pretty impressive for a handheld. But the problem with the visuals don't necessarily lie in the detail, but rather in the art style. I'm not familiar with the graphic novel the game is based on, but I think the setting for it is pretty depressing, so I can understand if the game's color palette looks a little muted. Personal preference on this one, if you're into that kind of style, then the game looks great. It can be a little on the difficult side, but never does it get to the point of frustrating. It's tough, but in a challenging and fun kind of way. If you can only get one game on this list, then I suggest picking up the Red Star. I'm absolutely loving this game. A true hidden gem. Now, if you want to see what other PSP games that are available in the PS Vita, then check out the next two videos. Thanks for clicking on the thumbnail, and as always, stay healthy, stay safe.